Good morning and welcome to Sycamore Presbyterian Live, the Easter edition. We're so glad you've joined us for worship this morning, wherever you may be, in your home or around the community, even around the world. We've gathered this morning to worship the one true and living God. And just because we're not meeting together as a church doesn't mean that there aren't some things going on that we can gather together at other times throughout the week for. Beginning next week, before our 11 o'clock worship service, we'll have a Sunday school class taught by Glenn Kurtz in the book of 2 Corinthians titled Don't Lose Heart. It'll be from 9:45 to 10:45. The details on how you can log in and join that, we're in the weekly newsletter. You can also call or email the church office. We'd be happy to provide them for you. There's also ways that you can serve during this time, our community. We're making masks for local nursing homes and hospitals and dropping those off. And so if you have sewing ability and would like to make some cloth masks for us to drop off, you can find plans for those in the weekly newsletter, posted online, or you could probably just go and search online for cloth mask. We also serve each month at the Liberation Family Services, and we provide them a meal, and this month we're asking folks to provide some extra meals to hand to them so they have more food during this time when they can't be out and about as often. And so if you're willing to make a casserole or some other dish, please let us know. You can contact the office or Judy Ryder, who oversees that for us, and she can give you the details that you would need. I don't know about you, but as we head into the fourth week of being quarantined, I'm beginning to realize more and more the things that we've lost. This week hit probably the hardest this weekend, as we're not together this morning for worship. But it was also supposed to be Master's Weekend, which many of you may not care about, but it is a part of tradition for me and for my family and for my girls to sit down together and watch Sunday at Augusta, Sunday at the Masters, and we can't this year. So it's beginning to come, the little things that we have lost because of this virus that is running through us and through our community. I know many of you long for us to be able to be together. And on this Easter Sunday, we have a hope that because of the power of the Spirit that unites us to Christ, a hope that says one day we will be together. Not just in corporate worship, not just gathered here again at Sycamore in body as the family of God, but eternally. A hope that says there will one day be no more sickness and sadness, no more quarantines, no more viruses. We have a Savior who raised from the dead. We call out this morning, O death, where is your sting? For he has swallowed it up. And so we gather this morning as God's people to worship a risen Savior and to proclaim a hope to one another that is far bigger and greater than just being together again. One that says our sins have been forgiven, and promises that our tears will be wiped away. And so as we prepare our hearts for worship this morning, reflect upon that. Think about the fact that Christ, our Savior, has defeated death for us, for you, and for me. So let's prepare our hearts now to worship our true and living King.
After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, Christ is risen."
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Sons of man and angels say, Alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high. Alleluia. Sing ye lands and earth reply.
Pray with me. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we come this morning. We come this morning rejoicing, for you are victorious. For Christ is risen. We come this morning praising you for the power you have even over death itself. We come this morning praising you for the forgiveness of sins, for the hope of the resurrection. We come this morning praising you that justice and wrath has been poured out the cross at Calvary on Christ our Savior. We come this morning praising you for the power of the Spirit you have given us, the power that gives us over sin itself, that we now, through the Spirit, can say no to our old selves, that through the Spirit we can walk in the resurrection life, in the hope and the promise of a glorious future secured for us by Christ Jesus our Savior. We come this morning praising you for the beauty of creation in the springtime, for the flowers, the green of new life. We come this morning to worship you. We ask for you to be among us as you have promised, even as we are apart. As we gather this morning for worship, may your Spirit be at work in us. May your Spirit be reminding us of the glories of our inheritance. May the Spirit be at work in us that we may worship you, O Father and Son and Holy Spirit, in truth. We pray these things in the name of Christ, our risen Lord. Amen.
There is a present reality to our faith, the historical connection we have with others in our faith, and a grounding in the fact of the life, death, and resurrection of Christ. In our present expression of faith, the slides that you've seen in the background behind the music are pictures that Tony Silvestro took in the last 2 days, including the sunset from yesterday. As you cannot gather together to church, we wanted to bring the beauty of God's creation to you at home. In our historical connection with others in faith, we're going to read from the Valley of Vision, a prayer confessing our sins and remembering the cross. Its title is Love Lusters at Calvary. When you polish silver, it's the rubbing, it's the friction, it's the abrasion that with the polish takes the tarnish off and the silver shines through. In the suffering of Christ on the cross, the love of God shines through. Love lusters at Calvary because in fact, this happened. And Jesus lived, died, and rose again because we needed a Savior. We need a Savior. He paid for our sins on the cross. So let's read this passage responsively. Join with us at home in the response as we read, Love Lusters at Calvary. My Father, enlarge my heart, warm my affections, open my lips, supply words that proclaim love lusters at Calvary.
Their grace removes my burdens and heaps them on thy Son, made a transgressor, a curse, and sin for me.
There the sword of thy justice smote the man, thy fellow, Christ. There thy infinite attributes were magnified, and infinite atonement was made.
There infinite punishment was due, and infinite punishment was endured.
Christ was all anguish, that I might be all joy.
Cast off, that I might be brought in.
Trodden down as an enemy,
that I might be welcomed as a friend.
Surrendered to hell's worst,
that I might attain heaven's best.
Stripped, that I might be clothed.
Wounded, that I might be healed.
Athirst, that I might drink.
Tormented, that I might be comforted.
Made ashamed, that I might inherit glory.
Entered darkness, that I might have eternal light.
My Savior wept, that all tears might be wiped from my eyes.
Groaned that I might have endless song.
Endured all pain that I might have a glory diadem.
Bowed his head that I might receive welcome.
Closed his eyes in death that I might gaze on unclouded brightness.
Expired that I might forever live.
O Father, who spared not thine only Son, that thou might spare me, all this transfer thy love designed and accomplished. Help me to adore thee by lips and life. Oh, that my every breath might be ecstatic praise, and my every step buoyant with delight. Heavenly Father, as we come to confess our sin, we find the joy of forgiveness for sin that is purchased for us by Jesus Christ, who gave his life for us. And so we come with thanksgiving and praise that you forgive us of our sin, and by the power of the Spirit, you enable us to turn from it to follow our Savior. He taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. In accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. Amen.
Let us now confess our faith together as we confess the words of the Apostles' Creed, not just with one another, but with those around the world and with those across millennia who have used these words to profess their faith in Christ. So, Christian, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, and he ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, and the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I understand that our live stream has been down as many people are tuning in to Easter services. We are handling so that at least the service will be recorded and we can pray that. It's interesting that when live stream is dead, we're praying for it to come back to life on this Resurrection Sunday. Our key verse is one that we cannot miss. It's in the middle of John chapter 11. And Jesus said to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" Let's pray. Heavenly Fathers, we remember the resurrection of Christ. As we look at this passage when he demonstrated his power over death with Lazarus, we pray that you would lift us up, that you would raise us in faith to life that is eternal, that begins now through faith in Jesus. It casts away fear, and it gives hope and encouragement to all who belong to Christ. Fill us with that this morning as we look into your word. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At the beginning of the service, we read from Matthew's Gospel in chapter 28, where the angel said to the women when they went to the tomb and the stone was rolled away, they were there to anoint the body of Christ, but something had happened that was beyond their expectation. The angel said, "He is not here. He has risen just as he said." He has risen just as he said. That was the message of the church. The disciples weren't brave and courageous. They didn't make this up. They were cowering in fear until the resurrected Christ appeared to them. The women went and told them, "He's risen. This is what the angel told us." And the disciples didn't believe the women. Jesus appeared to the disciples, except for Thomas, who was not with them the first time. And when Thomas came back, they said, "Jesus is risen." And Thomas said, "Unless I see his hands and his feet, I cannot believe it." That's why he's called Doubting Thomas. And then the next week, Jesus appeared and Thomas was with them. And he said, "Look, my hands and my feet." And Thomas fell down at his feet and said, "My Lord and my God." In Acts, we find the first sermon preached after Jesus was ascended into heaven and the Holy Spirit came upon the disciples, the followers of Christ. The first sermon preached by Peter begins this way in chapter 2, verse 22. "Men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's set purpose and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him." It was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. Death swallows us up, and we cannot in ourselves defeat it. It says, though's the cat that swallowed the giant mouse that had a grenade inside. Jesus was swallowed up by death, and the infinite Son of God burst its power. It was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. And on this morning, we celebrate he has risen. He is risen. And that is the basis of our hope. But it's not just a fact in history. It's something that applies to us. He has risen, and he raises us up from the dead. He comes to us with resurrection power and shares with us his victory over death. He is Lord and Christ over life and death, not just that death couldn't hold him, but death cannot hold all who belong to him. And so we turn to the Gospel of John, where before Jesus himself rose from the dead, demonstrates his power and authority over death for the third time. He raised Jairus' daughter back to life. He raised the son of the widow of Nain back to life. This is likely the third occurrence. And this is with a friend. This is a family that Jesus knew well. And we read from the beginning of chapter 11, "Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, 'Lord, the one you love is sick.' When Jesus heard this, Jesus said, 'This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it.'" Right here, we need to stop and say that Jesus knew what he was going to do from the beginning. He said, "This sickness will not end in death." It doesn't guarantee what Jesus planned on doing to raise Lazarus immediately back to life, because Mary, Martha, and Lazarus believed in the resurrection in the end, on the last day. We know that from later in the chapter. And Jesus could have been saying, "This sickness will not end in death because of the resurrection at the last day." But he had even bigger plans than that. Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Yet when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Now here we can begin to identify with this episode in the Gospel of John. Because when bad things happen to us, we wonder, where is God? I know he loves me. He's proven it in Christ. We worship him. We pray to him. He is our ever-present help in time of trouble. But why doesn't he just come and fix this? We pray and we pray and we pray. How could he let a loved one die? How could he allow this sickness into my life? I don't understand. Here in this passage, we know, first from Jesus' perspective, that he knew what he was going to do. He was sovereign over this situation. We know he loved them, yet he stayed where he was 2 more days. He had big plans, bigger than the people involved could see. That's an aspect of faith that we need to have, that our trust is in God who knows everything, who's sovereign over everything. His plans are bigger than we can see. And when we can't see the whys and wherefores, we still can trust him. Then he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea." "But Rabbi," they said, "a short while ago the Jews tried to stone you." That was back in chapter 8. We looked at that last week. "And yet you're going back there?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? A man who walks by day will not stumble, for he sees by this world's light. It is when he walks by night that he stumbles, for he has no light." This is kind of an enigmatic saying of Jesus. What was he saying here? He's basically telling his disciples, "You don't know the plan. You're walking in the dark. Just trust me. Follow me. I am the light of the world. I know what I'm doing." That's a message for us too. We walk in darkness. We see as in a glass darkly. So why would we trust our judgment of things? Let's trust in God. Let's trust in him who's proven his love for us. even when we don't understand. After he had said this, he went on to tell them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up." His disciples still don't see the whole picture. They replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better." Jesus had been speaking about his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. You see, they didn't want to go to Jerusalem. They knew that those who are out to stone Jesus would not be friendly towards the followers of Jesus. And with their limited vision, they're thinking, if he's just asleep, we don't have to go, do we? How often do we scramble with our limited knowledge? We don't just trust God to know what he's doing. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, and for your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him." What a strange thing to say. We don't know how rampant this coronavirus is going to get. There are hopeful signs this week, and we praise God for those hopeful signs. Jesus taught us to pray, "Give us this day our daily bread. Provide for us, Lord. Our jobs are all disrupted. Lead us not into temptation, that time of testing, but deliver us from evil." We can pray, "Deliver us from this illness." We praise God when there are hopeful signs. But if that is all we hope in, then it's kind of hard to hear God say, "I'm glad for your sake that I'm not right there right now." He spiritually is, but the incarnate Jesus is not with us to do that miracle, to make it all go away. It almost seems callous, doesn't it? "I'm glad for your sake that I was not there." But Jesus knows his bigger plans, "so that you may believe." If he had gone immediately and healed Lazarus, that would have been a miracle. He planned on going to raise Lazarus back from the dead, to prove his authority over death. We don't know the bigger work that God is doing in our lives and in the lives of others through the things he allows into our lives. Then Thomas, bless his heart. You know the Southernism, what bless his heart means. Bless his heart means what an idiot. Then Thomas, called Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, this is the Thomas who doubted Jesus' resurrection, who had to see Jesus for himself. And Jesus said to him, "Blessed are you because you've seen. You believe because you've seen, but blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe." We have a greater privilege than Thomas has in our faith in Jesus. Thomas still didn't have the faith that Jesus was going to do a great work. But he had loyalty. He had commitment to Christ. This is actually astounding faith. Would you have had the courage to do what Thomas did here? He said, "Let us also go that we may die with him." That's faith. You know, when we stumble, when we fall, when we can't see it, when we don't know what God is doing, when we're all downhearted and discouraged, just be loyal. Just be committed to Jesus. Just follow him, and you'll see the great work that he has done and will do in your life. And so we come to the events in Bethany. Verse 17, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died." We'll pick that up when Mary says the same thing and talk more about that. But there's still some faith in Martha's hope in Jesus. Perhaps she had heard about the daughter of Jairus, the son of the widow of the town of Nain. And she hoped still, said, "Even now, God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus didn't say, "Don't worry, I'll fix it." He didn't address her with her immediate request. He called her to something higher and greater. He calls her to faith in him for the eternal life that he came to bring, not just for the answer here and now. Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Now we know, because we know the rest of the story, that Jesus is talking about today. He will rise. But I think he says it in this ambiguous way to point to the ultimate resurrection. And Martha knows where he's going with it. Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." How many times do we respond to God like that? We know things that are his promises in the Bible. We know that those who believe in Christ will not perish but have eternal life. But we've fallen sick. We've got a real struggle. We've lost our job. A relationship is broken. We are hurting. And we come to God in prayer and we pray, "God, please, please fix this. I know you can do whatever you will." And you call on us to pray. So we ask you, we plead with you. And God, through his word, says, "You will rise again at the last day." And we respond, "I know. I know I'll rise again at the last day." But we say it in the spirit like, "But that doesn't really help me out today." It's so easy for us to fall into that. And I think Martha was responding that way. So I'm like, "I know, but it sounds like you're not going to help me out now." And Jesus calls her to a kind of personal faith and trust that is our key verse. Jesus said to her, "I am." We've noticed in John, when Jesus says, "I am," and back in John 8, it stood alone before Abraham was, "I am." The "I am" statements in John are famous. "I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world." Jesus is claiming to himself the very name of God that God gave to Moses at the burning bush. "I am who I am." And what he's claiming here is the ultimate. "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies." I actually love the way the ESV and the King James says this. "He who believes in me, though he die." It says it at a principle level. Though he should die, yet will he live. "And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." It doesn't mean we won't die physically. It's whoever so lives beyond death will never die. It is eternal life. And Jesus is saying, "I am that resurrection and life. Do you believe in me?" He asked Martha, "Do you believe this?" He asks you, "Do you believe this?" Here we don't know Martha's response in spirit. We know her words. I think she's comforted by this. She still could be saying, "I know, I know." But it seems to be a higher confession than that that brings comfort to her troubled soul. She says, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is to come into the world." Now, she still has no idea that Jesus is going to raise her brother back from the dead. But I think she submits with the kind of faith and trust that brings calm to her spirit, and she's just his. She goes back to the house. After he had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here." Now, I think it's fair to say that when Jesus arrived in town, up in the previous verse, in verse 19, in verse 20, it says, "When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home." The implication is that Mary heard too. It doesn't say that when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary didn't get the news. Mary didn't know he was there. It doesn't say that. It's Mary stayed at home. I think Mary is really mad at Jesus. Martha had this hope, but even now you can do what God will do for you, whatever you ask. Mary's just pouting. Have we drawn back in our faith because of trouble he's allowed into our lives? Mary, when she hears that Jesus is there and asking for him, you know how it is when you're kind of upset with somebody and you're drawing back from them, then somebody says, he's asking for you. Okay, I'm going to go and I'm going to tell him. That's what Mary does. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. We know from the first thing she said that she wasn't going happily and eagerly. Verse 30, now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. I think she would have noticed if it's like, what's happened? This seems to be happy news. Instead, she's mad. She's frustrated with Jesus. She goes out. She still looks in mourning, and they think she's going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet. That's wonderful. She belongs to Christ. She fell at his feet. That's an act of worship. If you're frustrated with God, just fall at his feet. Don't run away from him. Run to him with your frustrations. Fall at his feet, worship him, and then just pour out your soul. The Psalms are full of those kinds of prayers. And Mary says, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. The exact words that Martha said. So don't you know, in those 4 days since they had buried their brother Lazarus, Mary and Martha were saying to each other, if Jesus had been here, he wouldn't have died. If Jesus had been here, he wouldn't have died. I don't understand why he didn't come. We sent for him. He stayed there for 2 more days, and it took 2 days to get here. He could have come, but he didn't come. If he had been here, our brother would not have died. They were talking to each other about that, so it's the first thing out of both of their mouths. And when Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. And then the shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept. It's really hard for us to understand. If God is sovereign, why didn't you just fix it in the first place? If he's weeping, does that mean that he somehow fell asleep and missed it and wished it hadn't happened? Neither alternative is a faithful alternative. It's not true. God is sovereign. But he's not sovereign and callous up there. He grieves over our sins. The other place in the Bible it says Jesus wept. He wept over Jerusalem, because he knew that Jerusalem was going to crucify him and not believe in him. And he said, if you only knew the time of my coming and who it was that was coming to you. He wept over their sin. He wept over the consequence of sin here with death. He enters our grief. How many times when we have a friend who's suffering, who has a really bad thing happen, the loss of a loved one, do Christians want to go with the pious right answers and say, well, you know God works everything together for good. Why is that obnoxious? It's true, but why is it obnoxious? It's because really it's a kind of emotional and spiritual stiff arm. We're saying, I don't want to grieve with you. I don't want this to trouble me. So I know the right answer to it. So God will work all this out. And we leave people sitting there in their grief. Jesus didn't do that. He is sovereign, and yet he entered into their grief. And he wept. And the people around saw it, and they knew what it meant. Then the Jews said, see how he loved them. You know, the Bible tells us to weep with those who weep, to rejoice with those who rejoice. When we're in grief, it's hard for us to rejoice in somebody else's blessing, but that's actually called envy and coveting, and it robs our joy. It's also true when we're not in the midst of suffering, it's hard for us to enter into one another's grief and to weep with those who weep. We don't want to be burdened and troubled by that. But Jesus, who is sovereign, who knew what he was going to do, had the power to fix it all, did not say, "Don't worry, I'll fix it," and keep him at arm's length. He entered into their grief and he wept. There's something greatly comforting in that. As we have this shadow of a cloud over all of us, what's unusual about it is that we're all facing this global virus and the threat of what it could become. It has not yet become like the plagues in Europe that killed 2/3 of the population, and we pray that it won't. We don't even think it will. We're not at that level because we are listening to the authorities, we're doing the right things and staying socially distant, trying to mitigate it, and our hope, we have a kind of self-confidence that a vaccine, a treatment's going to come up, this isn't going to be a big problem. We're not facing the plagues of the Middle Ages, are we? And yet it's a shadow that hangs over all of us. But you know what? We're still mortal when we don't have this universal shadow. We still face individually the illnesses, the broken relationships, the struggle for provisions. We all face these things. It's when we're not doing it all together that we think life is secure. And yet it's not. It's not. There's something comforting to know that God cares about our suffering. And we can kind of rationally respond, but if you're sovereign, you can just stop it. God has a greater plan than we often can see. We're stumbling in the darkness when we're thinking that way. Because God wanted to demonstrate his love for us in a far greater way than just keeping us from suffering and living in our sin in the fallen world. He allows this world to be broken so that we can say, how can we trust in the things of this world? We need to trust in the one who overcomes the sin and death and gives us life eternal. That's what he wants for us. The Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, still with that cynical thing that we're so prone to, he said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? If he really loved him, why wasn't he here earlier? They weren't giving up on that. Oh, please, let's all of us give up on that one and just see, Lord Jesus, I trust you. Even when I don't understand, I trust you. Then let's see what Jesus did. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Now we know that Martha has put her trust in Jesus. She knows he will rise again at the last day. She has no clue. The one who said, even now, God will give you whatever you ask. I think she's given up on the immediate fix. She just kind of got lost there. And she now is so convinced that this miracle can't happen. I think if I had been Martha, although we often think so much better of ourselves than the characters that we're reading about, when we're put on the spot, how often do we trip up? If I'd been there, I might have started getting excited. He's rolling back the stone. I know that even now God will do whatever he asks. I heard that he raised the son of the widow of Nain. I heard that he raised Jairus' daughter. Is he going to do that for my brother? I might have thought that. But that's with 20/20 hindsight. It's not right there. Often when we are present, we were just stumbling in the darkness. Now, the King James often is more reverent with the older Shakespearean language. This time, there's more humor in it. In the King James, Martha says, by this time, he stinketh. He stinketh. And that's kind of become a saying when something bad happens, it just, this stinketh. It just reminds us. We get so frustrated with the circumstances, but our short-sightedness, we should be able to laugh at ourselves and the silliness of our unbelief. When Jesus has lived, died, risen again, and promises life to raise us up. He proves his power to do that with this immediate miracle. And he says, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? The fact is, she didn't believe. It's not the strength of their faith that raises Lazarus from the dead. He's just saying, trust me. Trust me. I'm going to do this. So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. Jesus is not calling people to follow him instead of the God of the Pharisees. His claim all along has been that the true and living God has sent him, God the Son, into the world. To receive Jesus is to receive God. To reject Jesus is to reject God. So he says it here, that this miracle is the very work of God through him. And when he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out, or come forth. You can just visualize what it must have been like. I think there's no mistake that when Jesus said, Lazarus, that was the call of Christ that raised him to life so that Lazarus could hear the call of Christ, come to me, come out. It's a picture of our regeneration. Picture Lazarus dead in the tomb. Jesus didn't say, Lazarus, if you put your faith in me, then I'll raise you to life. He couldn't hear. He was dead. Instead, he said, Lazarus. Lazarus awake in the tomb. I wonder what that was like for Lazarus. The light was coming in from the open grave. He is still wrapped in the grave clothes, and he hears the voice of Jesus, come forth, come to me. And he gets up. He's struggling in those wrapped around grave clothes, and he comes out of the tomb. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. The Bible says that we are born dead in our trespasses and sins. It's not just that we're sick. We're spiritually dead. We're unresponsive to God. But the work of God is this. He, by his Spirit, through the call of the gospel, calls you by name. He calls us by name, and when he calls us by his Spirit, he raises us to life spiritually so that we hear the call of the gospel. And when we hear the call of the gospel, we want to come. He's given us a new heart. He's made us alive so that when instead of being dead in our trespasses and sins and rebellious towards God, we come. And then we want to get all those sinful, the sinful attributes, those grave clothes, we want to shed them and follow our risen Savior. But not everybody in this passage did. I won't read all the verses of the remaining of the chapter, but the Pharisees hear about this. They see Lazarus. They are worried about this. In verse 47, then the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin. What are we accomplishing, they asked. Here is this man performing many miraculous signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. Then the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. We think that if we'd just been there and seen the resurrection, how could we not believe? If you knew somebody could raise the dead, would you not want to be his best friend? Except that Jesus comes to claim not only to be our Savior, but our Lord. And we don't want to lose that place in our lives. We want to do what we want to do. And so we find ridiculous faith, dismissing the one who has power over life and death, and saying, we got to stop this. We got to stop this. If this goes on, everybody's going to believe, and we'll lose our place in our nation. I'll lose my lordship over my life. Marty said that he loves Masters Golf Tournament. This is still the Masters Weekend, the Masters Weekend on the Lord's Day. But we want to be our own master. Is God calling you? Perhaps you have belonged to him for many years, but you're still stumbling like the disciples were. Oh, Lord, let's go to Jerusalem and die with him. We have a defeated attitude in life. were like Mary and Martha. If you had been here, this problem wouldn't have happened. Trust in him. He will raise you up. If you hear this message and you haven't given your life to Christ, is the Holy Spirit calling you now, saying, your name, arise, come to me, all you who are weak and heavy laden, I will raise you up. Lou Holt was a man in our church many years ago. He had been an athlete, a semi-pro baseball player, so he's quite an athlete. We didn't get to know him until he was older in age. He had retired, and he was not a Christian when he retired, but some friends invited him to go on a cruise. And he went on that cruise, and it was a Christian cruise. The presentations were not Broadway musicals. They were the gospel itself. And he came to faith in Jesus Christ and came back to our community and started coming to Sycamore back when we were meeting in the school. And in that same year that he came to faith, he lost his health. When he joined the church, he wept with joy, tears of joy. He just said, when I became a Christian, I lost my health. I'd always had good health. I was an athlete, and I enjoyed life, but I was afraid to die. And when I became a Christian, I lost my health. But the thing is, and tears just began to flow with tears of joy. He said, here's the thing. I'm no longer afraid to die, because he knew Jesus, who is the resurrection and the life. Jesus said, he who believes in me, though he dies, yet shall he live. And he who so believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? If you do, he will raise you up now and at the last day. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would enable us to worship you without all the outward circumstances that bring light and life. Let us worship you in the hard times, because you have broken the power of sin and death, and you bring a hope to us that the world cannot give, and a future to us that only you can give. We pray that we would trust in you as Lord and Savior. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
It is God who arms me with strength and makes my ways perfect. He makes my feet like the feet of the deer. He enables me to stand on the heights.
Lord, if it's you, Peter replied, tell me to come to you on the water. Come, he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, Lord, save me! Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. You have little faith, he said. Why did you doubt?
Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he tells his friends and neighbors, he calls them together and says, rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep.
But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. When I am down and oh my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come
Good morning. My name is Stephen Ryder. I'm one of the ruling elders here at Sycamore, and I ask that you'll pray along with me. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as we humbly come to you today with our petitions and praise, we know that you alone are our strength and joy. How amazing is your love! A love that overcomes, endures, and redeems. Our sin and darkness fall away, and your light and peace flood our lives. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the incredible celebration that we call Easter. Father, we pray as did your servant David. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your disease, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast mercy and love. Heavenly Father, I pray that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I pray that you'll comfort, heal, and restore your people, and resolve our spoken as well as unspoken concerns. If there's anyone in this assembly who does not have a saving knowledge of you, Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit will call them to repentance and faith in Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Heavenly Father, we lift up individuals with ongoing health problems and those recovering from surgery. Draw them close to you and grant them relief and rapid healing. Father, we pray this morning for Lori Sherry, sister of Candace Kelly, who recently suffered a stroke. We lift up her caregivers and pray that you will grant Lori a speedy recovery and virus protection. This morning, we pray for healing for Colin Elliott, a former member of Sycamore who has been sick and possibly has COVID-19. We also pray that Father Rich and Mother Lonnie Elliott be protected from this awful virus. Father, we lift up missionaries Dan and Janet serving you in Africa. We pray for protection from COVID-19 and for the unsaved to encounter the power of your gospel in word and deed. Father, we pray for Ben Robertson serving you with RUF at William and Mary, our Sycamore Young Adult Ministry, and our daughter church, Spring Run Presbyterian. We pray for the spirit of the resurrection to permeate metropolitan Richmond. Father, we lift up our pastor search committee and pray for an extra measure of strength and discernment as they carry out the final phase of their mission. Heavenly Father, be present with us as one nation under God as we battle an invisible enemy, the coronavirus. Give constant and wise counsel to our president and his advisors. Keep us all mindful of how small the earth is, how interrelated our lives have become, and how fragile security and peace is. Lord, our God, have mercy on us and grant us a swift victory over this dreadful enemy. We present all of these petitions in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Peace of God, my Father, rule my life in everything, that I may be come to comfort sick and sorrowing.
We come now to the time in our service where normally we would take up the Lord's tithe and our offerings, returning to the Lord a portion of that which he has blessed us with. And in these times, as you do that, I'd also remind you that we love our neighbors. So find ways to seek out and care for those in your community, in your neighborhoods, among your family and friends. A simple phone call, stopping by and dropping off some flowers or a balloon, goes a long ways. But also during this time, we have many who have lost their jobs, have been furloughed, who have had things that they had planned for income dry up. And so if you're able, lend a helping hand. Provide for those that you can. You can do that by giving to our diaconate fund here at the church as we receive benevolence requests and are able to meet them. You can even do that yourself. Out of those that you know who are in need. But giving to the Lord is an act of worship, returning to him a portion of that which he has blessed us with. Let us go to him in prayer now and dedicate to him the resources which he has given us and his tithes and offerings. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, praising you for the many blessings you have poured out upon us. You have prepared a table before us, before our enemies. You have blessed us. Our cup overfloweth. even in the midst of struggle and strife, even in the midst of anxiety and worry. You have blessed us richly, given us a hope that's enduring and eternal, a hope that is rooted in the resurrection of Christ, our Savior, a hope that promises us a future of glory and an inheritance that we share in with Christ, our brother. And so we come this morning asking for your blessing and dedicating your tithe and our offerings to the work of your kingdom. Lord, we pray for the many missionaries and ministries that we support here locally and around the world. During this time, they're wondering what their purpose is. They're seeking how to serve you in this new normal. And that you would bless them, that you would give them wisdom and insight, that you would give them a glimpse of your glory, a reminder of the harvest that you have called them to. Lord, we pray for the ministry of our church as we seek to love one another and to serve and love the community of Midlothian and those around us. Lord, we pray that you would use our church. You'd use the work of our hands. You'd use the resources that we give to be a blessing, but also to call people to faith, to call them out of their anxiety and their worry, and to call them to rest in Christ, whose burden is light. Lord, we ask for opportunities in this time, among our neighbors, among our family, among our friends, to share with them the good news of the gospel and the hope of the resurrection. We pray all of these things in the name of Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Rise, O church, and lift your voices. Christ has conquered death and hell. Sing as all the earth rejoices. Resurrection and from sin. Come and worship, worship Christ the risen King. See the tomb where death had laid him, empty now its lofty glares. Death and I could not contain him, for the throne of life he shares. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the risen King. Hear the truth, protest and tremble, see the stone removed with power. All hell's minions may assemble, but cannot withstand his arm. He has conquered, he has conquered, Christ the Lord, the risen King.
If the internet has been down and you indeed are watching this because it's been recorded, I suppose there is no better reason for the internet to be overloaded than for Christians to be worshiping Christ and overloading it on this Easter morning. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia.